the relationship in hypodyne may be transitive. For example, whereas hawk is a hypodyne of bird, kestrel and sparrowhawk are hypodynes of hawk. Okay? And finally, on sex relations in English, no, not finally, let's look at the example of collocation, which is an aspect of sense relations in English. Again, we describe semantic relations at the lexical level. Collocation is set up to account for the tendency of certain items in a language to occur close to each other. For example, let's take the term economy. When you hear the word economy, that word brings to mind other concepts such as affairs, policy, plan, program, and disaster. In the analysis of collocation, for example, economy is technically known as the nodal item or the node. That is the dominant word, while words like affairs, plan, policy are called the collocates or the span of economy. So, in the simplest terms, collocation has to do with the arrangement or juxtaposition of words. Collocation is based on the probabilities of occurrence of words or the mutual expectancy of words. Of course, what collocation presupposes is that the process of considering groupings of words involves the consideration of the whole context in which the word occurs. Thus, take the word car. Learning that word might involve learning some of the words that collocate with it. Of course, I mean, once you mention car, we seem to know instantaneously words that tend to collocate. That is, you know, words that can be found in the same linguistic environment as car. And such words, of course, are very common. Words like driver, accelerate, stop, sit, bet, gas, oil, and so on. Of course, these, all those words are the collocates of car. Some scholars have pointed out that the technical concept of merodyne can be considered a special case of collocation. Of course, in semantic analysis, merodyne is used to describe a part or relationship between lexical items. And I believe that the counterpart of merodyne in literary studies is synecdoche. Of course, synecdoche again has to do with the part or relationships between certain things or items. For example, talking of merodyne as an aspect of collocation, the words cover and page are merodynes of a book. Okay? We can talk about this relationship by using sentence frames like X is a part of Y, or Y as X, as in a page is part of the book, or a book as pages. So, what do you think are the merodynes of car, which we have just mentioned? Remember that hypodyne has to do with X is type of Y, while merodyne has to do with X is part of Y. So, what are the merodynes of a car? Of course, your guess is as good as mine. What are the parts of a car? A car, of course, has side up, windshield, and so on. Okay, these are parts of a car, right? And then finally, talking about sense relations as a crucial aspect of semantic relations. In English, let's talk about componential analysis briefly. In some literatures on semantics, Componential analysis, or CA for short, is also known as lexical decomposition or semantic feature analysis. CA is another word used for the analysis of words. Okay. And this approach can be used to analyze several of the meaning relationships we have talked about so far. But going straight to the point, I mean, we can use CA to define the meaning of words in English. Let's take the words woman, bachelor, spinster, and wife. We can do a CA meaning analysis of these words by using what are called semantic primes or primitives, or what some scholars will call semantic features or meaning components. I mean, and in doing CA, all you have to do is to impose the plus or minus signs on the meanings of words. For example, plus adult, plus human, plus female, and so on. So then, what is the meaning of the noun woman in terms of componential analysis? The meanings of women can be reduced to just three components. So, women can be defined as plus female, plus adult, and plus human. What about bachelor? Bachelor can be defined as minus female, because a bachelor is a man, plus adult. A bachelor is grown up, plus human. And, of course, minus married, which means that a bachelor, of course, is unmarried. And what about the opposite of bachelor, which is spinster? So, what are the meaning components of spinster in terms of componential analysis? Again, we can reduce the meaning of spinster to just four components of meaning. Plus female, plus adult, plus human, and minus married. Of course, it has been pointed out that a statement of semantic components is also more economical if we include some redundancy rules. The focus here is on what are called redundancy rules, which predict the automatic relationships between meaning components. And what do we really mean by these so-called redundancy rules? The redundancy rules proceed that some features need not be specifically mentioned, meaning that certain features can be rendered redundant when we are doing CA of words. For example, if a word has the feature plus even, then we know the redundancy rules can predict that word is also automatically plus animate. So, in specific terms, this rule says that plus animate, that is the feature plus animate, need not be specified in the lexical entry for lexical item such as father, girl, and professor, since it can be inferred or deduced from the feature plus human. For instance, without positing redundancy rules, the semantic component for wife could be stated as follows: plus female, plus human, plus adult, plus married, plus animate, and so on. But when we posit the redundancy rules, the meaning of wife stops at the feature plus married. Now, let us move on to semantic relations at the sentence level. In this section, we want to explore a few of the semantic relations that may hold between sentences of the English language. Of course, we cannot cover the whole gamut of sentence relations at the semantic level. No, at the sentence level, pardon me. But, of course, we can describe three of the semantic relations of entailment, presupposition and thematic roles, starting with entailment. Let's look at the following two sentences, which we will describe as sentence A and sentence B. Sentence A, the gunman killed the king. B, the king died. The gunman killed the king is known as the entailing sentence, while sentence B, the king died, is the entailed sentence. In tactical terms, sentence A entailed sentence B, because we could say that if somebody tells us A and we believe it, then we know B without being told anymore. Or we could say that it is impossible for somebody to claim A and then go on to deny B. And according to Professor Said, in 1997, we can formulate a truth-based definition of entailment as follows. A sentence P entails a sentence Q when the truth of the first P guarantees the truth of the second Q, and the falsity of the second Q guarantees the falsity of the first P. There are lexical and syntactic sources of entailment, and that means we can recognize entailment by the presence of certain keywords and sentence structure. Of course, the lexical sources of entailment may relate to certain concepts we have considered under sense relations in English. These concepts include synonymy, hyponymy, converse relations, and antonymy. For example, in relation to synonymy producing entailment, let us go back to our previous sentence here. The gunman killed the king, which entails the king died. Of course, the relationships between sentences A and B derive from the lexical relationship between the words kill and die. In a certain sense, the meaning of kill contains the meaning of die. When we discuss English semantic relations at the lexical level, we call a similar relationship of meaning synonymy. Furthermore, hyponymy between lexical items is a regular source for entailment between sentences. For example, the noun dog is a hyponym or type of animal. So, in the following pair of sentences, sentence A entails sentence B. For example, in sentence A, I bought a dog. The key word there is dog. So, the presence of dog entails sentence B. I bought an animal today. What you need to know here is, of course, dog is a hyponym of animal. And that means that sentence A entails sentence B. By the same token, entailment can also be used to describe converse relations, which, as we pointed out, is an aspect of antonymy in English. Let us consider the following two examples, sentence A and B. John owned this book, of course, entails this book belongs to John. In this particular example, we observe that we are talking about the same John and same book. Still on antonymy, the lexical relation of simple or binary antonym can produce entailment, as in the following relationship between the lexical items beat and lobster. Sentence A, Canada beat the US in World Hockey Tournament, versus sentence B, the US lost to Canada in World Hockey Tournament. Here we are concerned with the antonyms beat and lost to. The presence of bit in A, of course, means that A entails B. So the distinction here is between the binary antonyms bit and lost tone. And that brings also presupposition, which some scholars will consider as the twin sister of entailment. In ordinary language, to presuppose something means to assume it. Okay? Up front, let's consider the following presupposition appears. Sentence A, he has stopped beating his wife. Of course, presupposes he used to beat his wife. Here, sentence A is the presupposing sentence, while sentence B is the presupposed sentence. In other words, sentence A presupposes sentence B. Or, I don't regret leaving the country, that presupposes B. I left the country. The Prime Minister of Canada is in Asia this week, presupposes B. Canada as a prime minister. Like entailment, we can define presupposition as a truth condition in English in three steps. Of course, with some people, with some scholars, we call syllogism, but I mean, we need not go into the technical details of syllogism here. But all we need to know at this point is that presupposition can be defined as a truth relation in three steps. Step one, if P, that is the presupposing sentence, is true, then Q, that is the presupposed sentence, is true. Step two, if P is false, then Q is still true. And the final step is, if Q is true, P could be either true or false. The point here is that viewing presupposition as a truth relation allows us to capture an important difference between entailment and presupposition. In other words, there is a key, pivotal difference between entailment and presupposition. And that is, please pay close attention to this point. If we negate an entailing sentence, then the entailment fails. But negating a presupposing sentence allows the presupposition to survive. Let's take the following entailment pair, which we furnished earlier on. The gunman killed the king, of course, entails the king died. The point is that once we negate A, then it no longer entails B as follows. So, once we negate A, to read, the gunman did not kill the king, then the entailment does not survive. In other words, the gunman did not kill the king does not entail the king died. Now, sentence B no longer automatically follows from the preceding sentence. Compare this with the following presupposition pair. Sentence A, the governor of Lagos State is in town, which presupposes B. Of course, what that means is that there is a governor of Lagos State, or Lagos State as a governor. The point here is that, unlike entailment, if we negate sentence A, the resulting sentence still has the presupposition as follows. So, let us go ahead and negate sentence A, which now reads, the governor of Lagos State is not in town. Of course, negating that sentence does not affect the preposition or truth value of B. The presupposition still remains constant. There is a governor of Lagos State. And this brings us to the very important question of presupposition triggers. What are called presupposition triggers? And several scholars have pointed out that certain types of presupposition are produced or triggered by particular words or constructions, which together are sometimes called presupposition triggers. Many presuppositions are produced by the presence of certain words. Of course, many of these lexical triggers are verbs. For example, there is a category of verbs called factive verbs. Remember that word, factive verbs, because factive verbs presuppose the truth of the accompaniment clause. That is the clause that follows the factive verbs. Factive verbs in English are very many, but they include the following. Verbs like discover, find out, forget, fear, know, learn, notice, realize, regret, remember, and understand. For example, the following sentence A with the factive verb realize presupposes sentence B. Sentence A, John realized that Mary had dandruff. Remember that in A, we are dealing with a complex clause or sentence. Complex because this sentence has two clauses. The main clause is John realized, followed by a subordinate clause, that Mary had dandruff. So, John realized that Mary had dandruff. What we're trying to say is that the factive verb realize triggers B, Mary had dandruff. In other words, Mary had dandruff is embedded in the complement clause. Let's take another example of factive verbs in English. John regretted eating the banana. Again, this is a complex sentence. And here, we notice the presence of regretted, which is a factive verb. And that means the clause that follows that factive verb is perforce, presupposed. So, the presupposed sentence here is John ate the banana. As we pointed out earlier, negating the presupposing sentence does not affect the presupposition. Thus, the following sentences, which are A and B, still presuppose C. Sentence A, we forgot that the meeting was cancelled. The factive verb here is forgot. B, of course, we can negate sentence A. We didn't forget that the meeting was cancelled. Again, A and B still presuppose the meeting was cancelled. Still on lexical triggers, a special class of verbs called verbs of judgment can produce presupposition. Compare the following sentence here. John blamed me for telling her. The verb of judgment here is blame. Again, here we are dealing with a complex sentence. The main clause here is John blamed me. And the subordinate clause is for telling her. So, the presupposition is embedded in the subordinate clause or the complement clause. So, John blamed me for telling her presupposes I told her. As a final example of lexical triggers, a category of verbs known as change of state verbs can trigger presupposition. These change of state verbs include start, begin, stop, used to, and used not to. These verbs are the kind of switch presupposition, that is, the new state is both described and is presupposed not to have held prior to the change. In the following sentence, the A sentences presuppose the B sentences. For example, sentence A, which is the presupposing sentence, Judy started smoking cigars. The change of state verb here is started, and that can trigger the presupposed sentence. Of course, what we are trying to say is that the B sentence is the converse of the A sentence. In other words, we might say that sentences A and B have converse relations. So Judy started smoking cigars, presupposes Judy used not to smoke cigars. Or you take the two sentences, sentences A and B. Ada stopped having nightmares. The change of state right there is stopped. And of course, Ada stopped having nightmares presupposes Ada used to have nightmares. Once again, sentences A and B form a kind of converse relationships with each other. Finally, of course, before or previously, we talked about lexical triggers of presupposition. But now, we want to focus on the fact that some of the presupposition triggers derive from syntactic structure. That is from the particular structure of sentences. For example, in the following sentences, the cleft, what is known as the cleft construction of the cleft sentence in A and the pseudo cleft in B share the presupposition in C. Sentence A, it was his behavior with snakes that disgusted me. This is known as a cleft construction in English. And the counterpart